Okay, so having studied the inverting amplifier, now we shall talk about this non-inverting amplifier. And if you compare the configuration, amplifier configuration, this non-inverting with that of inverting one, what you find that the feedback mechanism is same in both cases. That means we have applied negative feedback. The only difference is now in this case we shall apply the input signal to this non-inverting terminal. Okay. In case of inverting amplifier, the input was applied here at this node, and this node was associated with the inverting terminal. Okay. So, because the input is given here to the non-inverting terminal, this amplifier is said to be a non-inverting amplifier. Okay. That means, if you apply a input signal like this, if you apply a sinusoidal signal in this case to the input, to this non-inverting input, you are expected to get an amplified version of that input signal, something like this. Okay. The output signal amplitude depends upon the gain factor offered by this amplifier. Is it clear? The output is a replica of the input signal. The only difference is the amplitude gets amplified by the amplification factor. Okay. Another thing you notice in this case is there is no phase difference between the output signal and input signal. Both are in same phase. Okay. That is why this it is also called a non-inverting amplifier. Okay. Output is in phase, output voltage is in phase with the input voltage, unlike that of a inverting case where the output was 180 degree shifted version of the input signal, like that. It would be like this if it were a inverting amplifier. Okay, the output would appear something like this dotted curve. Okay. But in case of non-inverting amplifier, the output is like this. Okay. Amplified version of this input signal. Okay. Now, let us discuss the working principle or how this amplifier actually amplifies the signal. Okay. So, let us find out the gain factor for this amplifier first. So, gain factor for this amplifier is V naught by V I. Let us say that the gain is denoted by G. So, G is actually V naught upon V I. So, let us try to find out this V naught by V I for this case, considering this operational amplifier is an ideal one. Okay. If this is an ideal one, then in that case the virtual short condition holds true. That means, both input terminal will be at the same potential. Okay. So, if we consider here that A is infinity, gain is very high, in that case virtual short condition holds true. And in that case, if I consider the potential of this node to be Vx, then Vx is going to be Vi, that is equal to the input voltage in this case, okay, because of the virtual short condition. So, A tends towards the infinity says that Vx is equal to Vi. Okay. And once we have determined the potential of this node, we can find out the current passing through this resistor. Okay. Because this end is at zero potential, this one is at higher potential, let us say, then the current will be flowing from high potential to low potential direction in this direction. Okay. And the magnitude of this current, if I say it to be I 1, then I 1 is basically Vx upon R 1. Okay. Is it clear? And considering the fact that this operational amplifier is an ideal one, it is not going to take any current into. So, the current I 1 which is passing through R 1 will also pass through this resistor R 2 in this direction. Okay. That means, the current direction will be like this. It will originate from this operational amplifier and it will pass something like this. Okay, it will go into the ground. Is it clear? That is why we look for the low output impedance for any amplifier, okay, because it can support this amount of current, Vx upon R1 amount of current. Okay. So, the current flows like this, and if current flows like this, then we can find out the output voltage. The output voltage in this case is V naught. I can write V naught equal to Vx plus the potential drop in this resistor, because the polarity of the potential drop is to be like this in this case, because current is flowing from right to left. So, right node is at higher potential, left one is at lower potential. Therefore, I can write V naught equal to Vx plus there is increment of potential I1 into R2, and therefore, it is Vx plus R2 upon R1 into Vx. Okay. And Vx, as you can see here, that Vx is equal to Vi because of this virtual short condition. So, I can write here V naught equal to Vi into 1 plus R2 upon R1. So, the gain factor G equal is, which is V naught upon Vi, can now be written as 1 plus R2 upon R1 in this case. Okay. So, what you see, that gain is positive, therefore, output is in phase with the input. Okay. No change in the, no phase difference between the output signal and the input signal. It is because of this positive gain 1 plus R2 upon R1. Okay. And if you compare this gain with that of an inverting amplifier, you find almost equal gain. There it was R2 upon R1. Okay. If you look, if you consider the magnitude of that gain only, in that case it was R2 upon R1, whereas in this case it is 1 plus R2 upon R1. So, if R2 upon R1 is larger than 1, then we can say that gain in both cases are almost equal, almost same. Okay. What is the difference in these two amplifier? The difference is, one difference is the phase difference, which is 0 in this case, phase difference between output and input signal, and the another notable difference is the input impedance offered by this amplifier. Look what happens in this case, the input node is this. Okay. So, this node has to be supplied the input signal by a source. Okay. So, when we are interested about the input resistance, we shall we'll have to find out the input resistance at this node looking into this node. Okay. So, this is our input resistance Ri, and what this Ri is going to be? The input resistance Vi upon Ii, and what is Ii in this case? 0, because this is not going to draw any current, this node is not going to draw any current, I mean this input terminal, as this input was not drawing any input current. So, both currents are 0, that means the impedance which is seen from this point in this direction is actually infinity, because this branch is not going to take, this input terminal is not going to take any current from this voltage source. Okay. So, the input resistance Ri is infinity in this case, which is very, very attractive from an voltage amplifier perspective. Okay. This is one of the important parameter which we look for a voltage amplifier, that input resistance should always be very, very high. If it is infinite, that means it is ideal case, but Ri infinity is always attractive for a voltage amplifier. Okay. Whereas, R naught, output resistance, what about the output resistance? Output resistance in this case is same as that of the case of the inverting amplifier, because you see that you take output from this terminal, and looking into this terminal, you see that there is the same situation as that was in the previous case. So, output resistance is always similar in both cases, and that is quite low. It depends upon the output resistance offered by this operational amplifier, which is quite low. Okay. So, generally for a practical amplifier, for an ideal case the output resistance remains 0, whereas for a practical case the typical value of this output resistance may be 50 ohm, you can say. Okay. So, these two things are very, very good for a voltage amplifier: high input resistance, low output resistance. Okay. Is it clear? So, if you compare this configuration non-inverting with that of inverting, we always have certain advantages in this non-inverting configuration. Okay. The advantage of input resistance, high input resistance, and the phase difference to be 0. Okay. Is it clear? And again we have analyzed this case considering that the gain was infinity. Gain means the open loop gain for this operational amplifier was infinity. Okay. But if we consider a non-infinity gain, a practical value of gain, then this gain expression gets modified. Okay. Let us investigate what gain we are going to get if we consider A to be finite, not infinity. Okay. So, let us analyze this non-inverting amplifier for a practical case. So, for a practical case, let us say that the open loop gain for this operational amplifier is A. Okay. And if it is so, then the Vx in this case is not equal to Vi. Okay. If we consider this operational amplifier to be a non-ideal one, then I will have to write the V2 minus V1, that means V2 is Vi minus Vx equal to V0 by A. Okay. And therefore, the Vx, the potential at this node, is now Vx equal to Vi minus Vo divided by A. Okay. And using this potential of this node, now we can find out the input current I1. Okay. And what input current we can get in this case? I1 equal to the Vx divided by R1. Okay. So, it is 1 upon R1 into Vi minus Vo by A. Okay. And then what about the output potential V0? The V0 is the potential at this node Vx plus drop in this resistor, potential drop in this resistor. Okay. So, potential at this node is actually Vx, and Vx is a, can be written as Vx is Vi minus V0 by Va and plus the drop in this resistance, this resistor, that is I time R2, I1 time R2. So, it is R2 upon R1 into Vi minus V0 by A. Am I right? The first two terms is, the first two terms are basically potential at this node Vx. Vx is from this equation Vi minus Vo by A. Okay. And then this second term is potential drop in this resistor, R2 time I1. I1 is 1 upon R1 Vi minus V0 by A. Okay. Then I can rearrange the terms here. I can take Vi minus Vo by A common out from the bracket, and I can get here in bracket 1 plus R2 upon R1. Can I do this? I took out this Vi minus Vo by A out from the bracket. Okay. And again after rearranging the terms, collecting all V naught terms towards the left and Vi terms towards the right, I can get V naught 1 plus 1 upon A into 1 plus R 2 upon R 1 equal to 1 plus R 2 upon R 1. Into Vi. Am I right? Just I have rearranged the terms. I have taken few terms from right hand side and written them to towards the left hand side. Okay. And from this expression, I can find out the gain V naught by Vi. So V naught by Vi in this case is, which is the gain factor, overall gain for this amplifier is 1 plus R 2 by R 1 divided by 1 plus 1 upon A into 1 plus R 2 upon R 1. Okay. So, what is the common factor in this expression and the gain of that of an inverting amplifier? The denominator. Okay. The denominator is same in both cases. I get here 1 plus 1 upon A, 1 plus R 2 upon R 1, where the numerator is the gain in ideal condition, 1 plus R 2 upon R 1. Okay. And if I just put A tends towards infinity in this expression, this gain expression actually reduces to 1 plus R 2 upon R 1, which we have derived earlier. Okay. Please note that this gain G is the gain for this entire circuitry arrangement, for this amplifier, okay, whereas the A is gain of this operational amplifier only. Okay. That means A is the gain of this operational amplifier and G is the gain of this total circuit arrangement including this operational amplifier. I mean, we are giving the input signal here at this node and collecting output here. So, V naught upon V I is the overall gain for this amplifier, which is noted as G, and its value is 1 plus R 2 upon R 1. Okay. So, don't get confused between the capital G and capital A. Capital A is always an impractical value. Okay. Is it clear? In practice, it will be very high value and you cannot use that value directly. So, whenever you calculate the gain G for an amplifier, basically it is the practical gain G, I mean that is equal to 1 plus R 2 upon R 1 for this non-inverting case. Okay. Is it clear? So, it is shown here that even a generalized expression for the gain reduces to that of that ideal expression for the gain if I put A equal to infinity in this expression. Okay. Is it clear? Finding the difference between the non-inverting amplifier and inverting amplifier. Okay. Both have identical, almost identical structure. The only difference is in inverting case input is applied here, in non-inverting case input is applied here, both offers almost same gain. Okay. In one case it is minus R 2 by R 1, in another case 1 plus R 2 by R 1, but the difference is in case of non-inverting the phase difference between output and input is 0, whereas in case of inverting there is a 180 degree phase shift between input and output. Another difference is in case of inverting amplifier, non-inverting amplifier, the input impedance is infinite, which is really attractive point for a voltage amplifier. The input resistance for an inverting amplifier is only R 1, that is equal to the value of this input resistance, and the output resistance is 0 in both cases. Okay. Whether it is inverting amplifier or non-inverting amplifier, the output impedance is always 0. Okay. One of the use of this non-inverting configuration is to design a voltage buffer. Okay. As I have told you that a buffer is a important building block in a analog signal processing circuit. Generally, it is used to isolate one stage with the another stage. Okay. What we expect from the buffer is the input impedance for the buffer should be infinity, very high. The output impedance should be 0 and its gain should be unity. Okay. These are the characteristics required for a buffer, voltage buffer. So, you can see that this configuration can be converted into a voltage buffer very easily. Okay, let us see how. How to get unity gain from this configuration? R2 should be 0. R2 0 means short circuited. Okay, this is our target. This we want to get. Let me write it capital G here. This is our target characteristics. Okay. So, someone has pointed out that this R2 should be 0. In fact, this should be 0. R2 0 means I have to make it short. Okay. Open means infinite resistance, shorted means 0 resistance. Okay. So, once I make it short here, basically this has R1. I can also put R1 infinity. Okay. This has not to play any role. So, let me also remove this. So, what is left is called voltage buffer. The circuit which is left here is called voltage buffer. Okay. Why it is voltage buffer? Because if I apply the concept of virtual short, in case of virtual short, this node is going to follow this potential of this node, and this node is at potential Vi. So, potential here is going to be how much? Vi. And this potential is nothing but the potential of the output terminal. Is it or not? This node is directly connected with the output node. Okay. So, therefore, what we have? V0 is equal to Vi, and our gain G, which is V naught upon V I, now becomes 1. Okay. So, thus we get unity gain, and input resistance is always infinity because we did not change this node. I mean, we did not connect any additional component to this node. Therefore, the input resistance here is infinity. Similarly, the output resistance is looking into this node is always 0. Okay. So, thus we get this characteristics of an ideal voltage buffer. Okay. Why in this case we get unity gain, if you do not go to the circuit analysis? Because in this case we are going for a 100% feedback. Okay. In previous case you saw when we applied two resistances in series R1 and R2. In that case, only a fraction of the output voltage was appearing at the feedback point, at the input point, inverting point. But in this case, whatever is present at the output, that is coming back here as a input. So, 100% feedback means gain becomes unity. Okay. Circuit is perfectly stabilized to a unity gain. Okay. That is why we get unity gain in this case. Is it clear? 100% feedback. If you want to reduce the percentage of the feedback, then you have to apply, connect one resistance here, another one to here, and depending upon the resistance value, you can set the percentage of feedback at this node. Okay. Getting this point? So, 100% feedback ensures that the gain for this voltage buffer becomes unity. Okay. So, this is an interesting circuit arrangement. Whatever you provide at the input, that appears at the output with the additional advantage of high input resistance and low output resistance. Okay. So, this circuit is quite useful for connecting the other blocks which has not this kind of characteristics. Okay. Is it clear? So, this is voltage buffer which is implemented using a non-inverting configuration. Now, we shall take few more examples of operational amplifier based circuits. One of the example may be an integrated implemented by operational amplifier. Okay. So, let us see how an integrator can be implemented. Integrator implementation using operational amplifier. Integrator, or it is also called a Miller integrator. Okay. So, let me take a general circuit topology for this first of all. So, what I do here is I take a inverting configuration. So, this positive terminal is grounded, and what I do is here is taking a general impedance Z1 and another general impedance in the feedback Z2 like this. Our input voltage is given here, that is, let us say Vi, the output is V0. Okay. Both the input Vi and V0 are AC signals. Okay. And this is general impedance Z1. Are you familiar with the impedance? Impedance basically, it may include sometime a branch may have even inductor and capacitors apart from the resistor. Okay. So, this Z1 represents the overall impedance of that branch. Okay. For example, if you have a resistor R in series with inductor R and L. Okay. So, impedance Z1 here is basically under root R square plus XL square. Okay. So, this is the overall impedance of a branch. So, what I am going to do, I am going to consider a general case, because I am intended to use some inductive and R capacitive components. Okay. So, if there is a only resistor connected in this branch, then Z1 becomes simply R1 and Z2 becomes R2, and that is equivalent to our non-inverting inverting amplifier case. Okay. But if we consider a more general case where this branch may have some inductive component or capacitive component, and similarly this branch may also have inductive or capacitive component. Therefore, I write here Z1 and here I write Z2. Okay. So, if you write the gain for this amplifier with Z1 as an input impedance, Z2 as an output impedance, then again you can write the gain G equal to minus Z2 upon Z1. Okay. Getting this point? If both are resistances R1 and R2, so Z2 replaced by R2, Z1 replaced by R1. But let us say it also includes a series inductance. So, Z1 will be replaced by, in this case, R square plus root R square plus XL square. Okay. And if Z2 is R2, then in that case, Z2 is only resistive, then I can write R2 upon R1 square plus XL square, something like this. So, this is the gain, general gain for this assumptions. Okay. Getting my point? Now, what I am going to do, I will take this Z1 purely resistive with the resistance R1 and Z2 purely capacitive element, that means only a capacitor with the capacitance C. Okay. Is it clear what I did here? This input resistance is as it is, Z1 is R1 but here in place of that resistor I connect a capacitor. Okay. So, can you tell from intuition what will be the voltage gain V naught by V I for a DC input signal in this case? For a DC input signal means frequency of the input signal is 0. Why it is 0? Open circuited. Open circuited means no current flows. But you know that when this will be open circuited, what we will see is a bare operational amplifier which has a gain of infinite, not 0. Getting my point or not? So, in that case the gain for this the arrangement simply becomes the open loop gain for this operational amplifier. Okay. And what will happen in that case? The operational amplifier simply gets saturated at either at plus V set or at minus V set depending upon the polarity of the input voltage. If input voltage is positive, then you will find here plus V set. If it is negative, then you will find the output to be minus V set. That means saturation voltage. Getting my point? So, because at DC frequency, when frequency is 0, you will see that this will offer infinite impedance. This you can remove from the circuit. We get we are left with open circuited operational amplifier. Therefore, gain becomes infinity, and as a result at the output we get either plus V set or minus V set. That means this circuit is not going to work at DC frequencies, I mean for the DC signal. At 0 frequency, because of infinite impedance offered by this capacitor, this circuit will not work, don't work. Okay. So, this integrator basically works at for AC signal only. Okay. If the input signal is AC signal, if the frequency of the input signal is non-zero, then only this circuit operates. Okay. And let us see how actually it operates. First, we will do the time domain analysis, then we will go for the frequency domain analysis. Okay. I will show you how this circuit will behave like an integrator. Okay. So, again we can utilize the concept of virtual ground. Since this terminal is grounded, this one is at 0 potential. As a result, this node will also be at 0 potential. So, 0 potential means we will have a current flowing into, I mean from left to right through this resistor, and if that current is let us say I1, then this I1 is again V I upon R1. Okay. Okay, let us implement a non-inverting integrator. Okay, this was to be inverting integrator. Let us implement a non-inverting integrator. This will be more useful. So, for non-inverting integrator, what I have to do, this one is to be grounded and our input voltage has to be applied here. This is our V I. Okay. So, if it is V I, then this node will add potential V I, okay. And if it is V I, then the current flowing now flows in opposite direction, in this direction. So, if I 1 is flowing through this R 1, so I 1 is simply V I upon R 1. Okay. Please note that we are doing this analysis for AC signal only. So, this is small v capital I, small v capital I. Okay. And since this resistor is passing through, a current is passing through this resistor, so the same current will also pass through this capacitor. Okay. And that current is actually supplied by this operational amplifier. Okay. After all, a loop should be closed to support the flow of current. Okay. So, this much current is supplied by this operational amplifier which flows like this and finally goes into the ground. Okay. Now, what about the V naught, or what about the potential here? the potential across this capacitor, let us say it is Vc. Okay. So, you know that if a I current is flowing through a capacitor C, then the potential across develops across the capacitor is Vc equal to 1 upon C I dt. Am I right? I here is I 1. Okay. So, it becomes 1 upon C I dt plus I 1, I 1 dt. Okay. And I 1 is V I upon R 1. So, here we have 1 upon C R 1 into V I dt, and the limit will be basically from minus infinity to t, minus infinity to t. Okay. Is it clear? So, what will be our output voltage now? V naught. V naught is V I, which is the potential at this node, plus the potential developed across this capacitor. Okay. So, V naught is simply V I plus 1 upon R C 1 C R 1 or 1 upon R 1 C into minus infinity to T V I dt. Okay. So, you can see here that the output voltage and input voltage are related in this particular fashion. Okay. So, thus we have implemented an integrator. Okay. Please note that you can also implement a very simple integrator by applying the input signal directly here. If you apply the input signal directly here, and if this terminal remains grounded, so if V I is here, then in that case your current, due to the virtual short condition, the potential will be 0 volt here, and now the current flowing, the current I 1 is to be simply V I upon R 1, and that current will also pass through this capacitor, and that that causes a potential drop, potential developed across this capacitor with this polarity, because current flowing from right to left, and therefore the potential in that case V naught simply becomes equal to minus Vc, and it is 1 upon Rc 0 to minus infinity to t Vi dt. Okay. And we have got a straightforward relationship, I mean this relationship between output voltage and input voltage with this integral operator. Okay. No Vi term, unlike in this case we have a Vi term, but in this case we are not having any Vi term. Okay. And let us say that sometime you will see that capacitor has some initial charge. So, there is some initial potential present developed, already developed at the capacitor, and in that case I can write that V naught is simply minus V c minus 1 upon R c R 1 c 0 to t V I t t t. Okay. If there is a already a potential developed across the capacitor, that is minus V c, then I can simply write break this integral into two part, minus infinity to 0 and 0 to t. So, minus infinity to 0 integral of this V I dt means the potential which was already there across the capacitor. Okay. So, that is why I have written that equal to minus V c and minus 1 upon R c 0 to 2 V I t dt. Okay. So, here we have implemented an integration operation using the operational amplifier with one resistor and a capacitor. Okay. If you change the position of resistor and capacitor, if you interchange, then it becomes a differentiator. Okay. That can be also shown to you, and that will be in fact shown in the next class. you can replace this C with R and you can find the differential function. Okay. Is it clear? Now let us do the AC analysis for this integrator. Are you familiar with the S transform, Laplace transform? No. So, the impedance, if I write impedance rather than the resistance value, then for this resistor, if I write Z1, so Z1 becomes R1. What about Z2? Z2, that means impedance for this capacitor, 1 upon omega C. Generally, a more generalized version of that is 1 upon SC. Okay. S is called, S is actually j omega. Okay. S is an operator which is noted as j into omega. So, in S domain we write the impedance to be 1 upon SC. Okay. For inductor we write the impedance to be S into L, SL. Okay. For an inductor, if the inductance is L, so we write its impedance to be S into L, okay, where S is j omega L. J means it also tells about the phase difference between output voltage in input current or input current, input voltage and output current. Okay. So, this j means there is a 90 degree phase shift between output and input waveforms. Okay. So, it has more information. You are familiar with Z equal to 1 upon omega C or Z equal to this XL equal to omega L, but that equation basically misses those equation miss the output input phase differences. Okay. With this S parameter we can also incorporate the effect of the, show the effect of phase differences which are there between input signal and output signal. That is why it is a more generalized discussion of the same concept. Okay. So, the impedance for this capacitor is 1 upon SC, for this resistance it is only R1. Okay. So, if we take this inverting configuration, non-inverting, configuration, then I can write V0 upon VI is simply minus Z2 upon Z1, and as you know that Z2 equal to 1 upon SC, Z1 equal to R1. So, it is 1 upon S C R1. Okay. V upon VI, the output voltage upon input voltage, which is also called, if it is in frequency domain, it is also called the transfer function. Okay. So, the transfer function for this circuit is, if I write in omega domain, V0 j omega upon VI j omega, then it becomes minus 1 upon j omega C R1. Okay. S is equal to j omega. So, I have written here S equal to simply j omega. Okay. So, this is the transfer function for this given circuit. Transfer function has two different information. One is amplitude response, it also provide the information about the gain as well as the phase difference between the output signal and input signal. Okay. So, if you look at the gain for from this transfer function, so the gain is represented like this, mod T of omega. Basically, this insert this V0 by j omega upon VI j omega is also noted as T of omega, T of j omega. So, when I write the gain part, then I will write mod of T j omega, and the mod of T j omega which is gain simply becomes 1 upon omega C R1, whereas the phase for this, the phase difference between output and input, which is noted as the angle of T omega, is actually how much? 90 degree. okay. 90 degree means I have to multiply and divide by j. So, it becomes j, denominator becomes j square is minus 1. So, minus 1 minus becomes plus and in numerator I will have j, and j indicates 90 degree phase shift. Okay. So, therefore, the phase shift here for this transfer function is 90. Okay. What does it mean? It simply means that if I apply a sinusoidal signal here, okay, if I give a sine signal as a input signal, the output signal will become, output signal will have 90 degree phase shift with the input signal. Okay. And that will happen in an integrator. Integrator means you are integrating a function. If you are integrating a sine function, it becomes a cosine function. So, cosine means 90 degree shifted version of a sine signal. Okay, that is reflected from this phase angle. Okay, because it is an ideal integrator for a sine signal or for a signal with any frequency, there will be 90 degree phase shift between the output signal and the input signal. Okay, for an ideal integrator, it is always 90 degree. Okay, that's why when you integrate a sine signal, it becomes cosine signal. When you integrate a cosine signal, it becomes sine signal, because there is always 90 degree phase shift between sine and cosine. Okay, so integration sine omega t, you get cos omega t. Is it clear? That is reflected by this phase factor. Okay, and you can plot this mod of t omega versus omega. And you will get a straight line like this. This frequency cuts here, where omega becomes equal to 1 upon CR. Okay. If you put omega equal to CR, if this is in dB, so here 0 dB means the gain is unity, mod of t omega is unity, then only if you take the logarithmic of that, it becomes 0. So, this 0 dB means this is unity gain line. So, at unity gain line, when it becomes, when gain becomes unity, when this omega is equal to 1 upon CR1. Okay. So, that is why this is called the unity gain frequency omega t, it is equal to 1 upon CR1, the frequency at which gain becomes unity. Okay. But at 0 frequency, when omega equal to 0, you will see gain becomes infinity. Gain becomes infinity means this is open circuited, this capacitor is actually open circuited because of infinite impedance, and gain becomes infinity. That is why you will see that I am not starting with this from 0 frequency. At 0 frequency or very close to 0 frequency, it remains undefined, something like this. Okay. Is it clear? Okay. The transfer function always has two information, one is gain information, another one is phase information between the output and input signal. Okay. So, phase gain information is represented by mod of this transfer function t omega, phase information is noted by angle of this t omega. Okay. Angle of t omega is 90 means you see that this is function of omega and that is equal to 90. That means, whatever the frequency of the input signal is, the phase is always 90. Okay. Phase, whether you apply a sinusoidal signal of 1 kilohertz as the input signal, the output signal, input signal phase difference will be 90, or even if your signal input signal is 1 megahertz frequency, even in that case, the output signal, input signal phase difference will be always 90. Okay. So, let us stop here today. Next class, we shall continue this same discussion.